Hey guys, Victor here with Individual Investor. Today I want to talk about the return on invested capital, or ROIC. This is a financial ratio that Charlie Munger in particular pays very close attention to. He says that over the long term, the return on invested capital is a great indicator of the rate of return that you can expect on your stock price appreciation. Let's take a closer look. If you look up ROIC, you will come across different variations of the formula. But generally speaking, ROIC consists of taking the net income or the owner's earnings and dividing it by the invested capital. And this gives you the return on invested capital, which is expressed as a percentage. And obviously, the higher the percentage, the better. This means that the management of the company is doing a good job at allocating capital and therefore generating greater returns. If you read the Intelligent Investor book on chapter 15, they provide a definition for ROIC according to Christopher Davies from the Davies Funds. He defines return on invested capital as the owner earnings divided by the invested capital. If we break it down, we have that owner earnings equals operating profit plus depreciation plus amortization of goodwill minus income tax minus maintenance capex and minus income from unsustainable rate of return from pension funds. Then the invested capital would equal to the total assets minus cash plus past accounting charges that reduced invested capital. As you can see, that definition is not very straightforward. One definition that I personally like better because it's simpler to understand and calculate is the one from Investopedia. Investopedia defines return on invested capital as NOPAT divided by invested capital. NOPAT stands for net operating profit after tax, or basically net income minus dividends. And the invested capital equals equity plus debt minus cash and cash equivalents. So to put this into practice, we're going to calculate now the return on invested capital for Tesla using Tesla's 10K form from the year 2020. And we're going to be using this formula as defined by Investopedia. All right, to keep things simple for you guys, I have extracted here some screenshots from Tesla's 10K form with the relevant data that we need for our calculation. So the first thing we're going to need is the net income, and we can get it from the statement of operations that I have here on the second screenshot. Let me scroll down. So here we have the statement of operations, and if we find the bottom line income here on the bottom, we have that the net income used in computing net income per share of common stock is $690 million. Okay, so let me put that here, and this is all in billions, by the way, so we're gonna have to put 0.69. perfect. The next thing we need is the dividends. Tesla pays no dividend, so we're gonna leave that as zero. Then we need total assets and total liabilities. That's pretty straightforward. We can find that in the balance sheet that I have here on the right hand side. So here we have the balance sheet. If we go under assets, you have here the total assets. Okay, and if we scroll to the right, the total assets is $52,148,000,000. So that's gonna be $52,148,000,000. Now the liabilities over here, total liabilities equals to $28,418,000,000. So that's 418. Okay, now the equity, which you can see here already as 23 billion, the equity or shareholders' equity equals to total assets minus total liabilities. Okay, so 52 billion minus 28 billion, that gives us $23 billion. That's the total equity. Now the debt, we have it here in the under liabilities. There's two sections here that they're referred to debt. So here we have the first one, current portion of debt and finance leases. All right, so that's one portion of the debt, and that equals to $2.132 billion. So let me type here, $2.132 billion plus, there's another portion here for debt. Here it says debt and finance leases net of current portion. So that second line item is 9.556. Okay. 9.556. Okay. Perfect. So we have a total debt of $11.688 billion for Tesla. And finally, we need the cash and cash equivalents. So the cash and cash equivalents is right here on the top, and that's a total of $19.384 billion. $19.384 billion. Perfect. Okay, and here I have already the formula defined, which is basically what we have here in the bottom: net income minus dividends divided by equity plus debt minus cash and cash equivalents. Okay, so there we have it. Tesla for the year 2020 had a ROIC of 4.30%. As you can see, 4.30% is not that great of a return on invested capital. Most investors, as a rule of thumb, would only look at return on invested capital of at least 6 to 7%. However, if we look at Tesla's most recent ROIC, we see that it sits at about 11.45%, which is considerably better than the previous year. Okay guys, real quick, if you like this video so far, I would greatly appreciate if you can give me a thumbs up and subscribe to my channel. And also check out my other videos where I break down other financial ratios for you using real examples. Okay, so back to ROIC. As a value investor, how can you use the return on invested capital? Well, if you're comparing a handful of companies and you are comparing their financials, obviously one important factor will have to be the return on invested capital. So the companies with a higher return on invested capital should be favorable in your decision. Now, something that you also have to consider is the track record of these companies. You have to go back 3, 5, 7, 10 years and see what the annual average return on investment capital, invested capital is, and then figure out if they are expected to maintain that return on invested capital. If you have a company that has a consistent return on invested capital and that ROIC will continue to be roughly the same in the future, then you can use that as your baseline for the expectation of the rate of return for your stock price appreciation. So basically, your initial investment will be or will grow at least at the same rate as the return on invested capital. This is what Charlie Munger said, that over the long term, the rate of return on your stock will be at least as good as the return on the invested capital. And to prove this point, let's take a look at Apple and Microsoft over the last 10 years and compare some of the numbers. Okay, here we have Apple's numbers, and we're starting with the yearly ROIC figures or percentages starting in 2012. If we take each of the ROIC percentages and we calculate the annual average, we get an annual average of 29.94%. Okay, now if we take the stock price and we calculate the average stock price percentage price change per year for the same years, we get a average percentage price change of 30.54%. So basically, if you had bought Apple stock back in 2012, you would have gotten, on average, an annual rate of return of 30.54%. And as you can see, back to what Charlie Munger said, you see that the rate of return on your stock price appreciation is very close to the average ROIC of 29.94%. So there is a pretty high correlation there. And if we now look at the earnings or EBITDA, and we compute the EBITDA percentage change, we see that on average per year, the earnings for Apple have only increased on average 10.27%. So if we look, if you're basing your rate of return for your initial investment on the revenue growth or the earnings growth, then that won't give you a very accurate representation of the rate of return for your stock as opposed to the ROIC. And if we now do the same for Microsoft, we have here the ROIC for Microsoft, or the average ROIC for Microsoft in the last 10 years is 20.20%. Now, if we look at the average stock price or percentage price change for the stock for the same years, we get a percentage price change of 28.45%. So it's not as close as Apple, but still we can see some correlation there between the ROIC and the rate of return for the stock price. And lastly, if we now take the percentage EBITDA or percentage change in EBITDA year after year, we get an average percentage change of 15.80%. Okay, so this is pretty interesting because you can see that actually Microsoft had a greater change in earnings than Apple for the same years. However, the stock price for Microsoft grew slightly a couple of percentage points below Apple for the same number of years. But again, the point here is that you have to use, or you can use, the average ROIC as a long-term indicator of the expected rate of return that you can get on your initial investment for your stock. So again, I don't want to sound like a broken record, but if you find companies with a great return on invested capital, you will be in a very good spot. So this is one financial ratio that you want to keep in your toolbox at all times when screening for stocks. There's another ratio that actually Warren Buffett likes a lot, which is the return on equity, or ROE. I did a video on ROE a couple months ago. I will leave the link in the description below for you. One of the caveats though with ROE is that, as you might know, it doesn't take into consideration debt. So ROE is basically net income over equity. So you don't take into consideration debt. So if you see that ROE is increasing, this could be actually due to the company taking on more debt, and this causes the equity or shareholders' equity to become smaller, therefore driving their return on equity up. So that's why it's very useful and very good to use multiple financial ratios in combination to actually capture any red flags like this. All right, guys, that's all I have for today. I hope this video was informative. Thank you for joining me, and I will look forward to seeing you in my next video. Take care.